And I went out in the hall at break with a lot of people who were much further down the line than I am in terms of restoration, and everyone was going, wow, I had no idea. Courtney got the idea back in the 90s. It's the amazing thing when the Sierra Club was firmly against cattle in any way, shape, or form. He went down and worked with a rancher who was ranching for grassland restoration and coyote restoration and wolf restoration. And Courtney took this big jump that's still reverberating through the environmental community. And he decided, and he saw that cows could be, and ranching could be, not only could be, but it's essential to place ranching where it belongs as one of the most important restorative functions that we can have in the West or in the world. And at that same conference, Christine Jones, a soil scientist from Australia, was here, and she showed the root structure of plants in Australia on land that had been ranched correctly and on land that had been ranched poorly. And the difference was probably times five. And the root structure on the well-ranched land had a sort of a white nimbus around it. And she said, what you're looking at there is mycelium. You're looking at a structure that comes in when soil is able to absorb carbon. And that's really, I think Courtney will reiterate this, carbon is a very essential element. We just don't want a bunch of it in the atmosphere. We want it in the ground. And what happens when ranching is done correctly and farming, it sequesters carbon. And what Christine Jones from Australia was showing, that it will sequester carbon, good land will sequester carbon at a rate five times that of poor land. In fact, poor land won't even sequester carbon often. So what happens in well-ranched, well-managed land is you have a giant carbon sink, and the roots know exactly what to do with that carbon and all the microorganisms. So this man here, I think in his 10th anniversary, was showing slides, and I said, how much land have you positively impacted in New Mexico? This is a while back. He said, I think about 1 million acres. And this is where, and what I get a lot of times, in fact, after the radio show when we interviewed three women from Quivira about the upcoming conference, someone called in to remind me that, you know, David, cows are really, really bad and evil, and they destroy things, and you don't get it. And those two things are working hand in hand right now. There is definitely destructive ranching, definitely destructive farming, but the work Courtney's doing leads toward a whole ethic of not only restoration of land, but restoration of communities. So I'm going to stop yakking and turn the mic over to Courtney. Listen to him with an open mind, and we'll try and entertain questions, you know, in good enough time. But please give a round of applause for Courtney White and the Quivira Coalition.
Can everybody hear me, or should I use the microphone? Should I use the microphone? Okay. Thank you, David. I want to move this. And I'm going to move this. I'll block David, just so I can sit up here. And this is an informal discussion. I want to say a few things about our conference, about our work. Thank David. This is David and I have been having kind of a long-running conversation that stretches over probably 10 years now. I think David himself will tell you that he's gone through an evolution over the years. I've gone through an evolution over the years, and I hope folks in the room here have also gone through. Evolving is good, right? We all want to keep learning and changing. So my name is Courtney. I am the executive director of the Quivira Coalition, which is a nonprofit based in Santa Fe, and I'll tell you a little bit about that. But why I'm here, and we do this every year, is that we have an annual conference coming up. It's in Albuquerque. This year the theme is, how are we going to feed 9 billion people by 2050? And this is an important question for all of us, because there will be 9 billion people by 2050, and we can either feed them right or we can feed them wrong. And that's kind of the larger question here. And so as we get into this discussion, as you think of things, ideas come up, that kind of stuff. So feeding them wrong, I think most folks here understand that there is a way to feed a lot of people unsustainably. Let's go down the list of fertilizers, pesticides, GMOs, industrial agriculture, the Green Revolution. Is that, I mean, much to folks, the word the Green Revolution, what happened in the 60s, the kind of the sort of plant gene manipulation and the fertilizers and everything that came on and fed a lot of people. Well, there's the powers that be, the Monsantos and folks want a Green Revolution Part 2. They're talking about it. They're actually talking about, believe it or not, engineering, re-engineering photosynthesis. Now let's think about this for a second. I kid you not. And so we start thinking about, we think of a theme every year for our conference, and we've moved kind of into food and farming as well as ranching. We've been doing creek restoration for many, many years, which I'll talk about a little bit. We thought, well, goodness, if we don't speak up about this, if we don't pose a kind of alternative to that model, then Monsanto, those folks may, in fact, convince the public that the best way to feed 9 billion people is their way. And once we start thinking about that, we asked ourselves, well, how would we feed 9 billion people? And that's what the conference is. We actually have kind of a who's who of speakers from around the world coming to talk about agroecology, talk about organic farming. Organics can feed the world. They have data now to show how. So how do you intensify food production sustainably? How do you not wipe out what's left of the natural world? Because one of the arguments that's made about feeding a lot of folks is to move into those marginal zones that are left, you know, where the deserts kind of creep in. We want to do that. We figure out other ways to get more food per drop or crop per drop. How do you use water more efficiently? One of the speakers who's coming, Sandra Postel, is a world-renowned water policy expert. So I would first off like to encourage folks to come on down to the conference. It's November 14, 15, and 16. I didn't bring, being Sunday morning, I didn't bring much show and tell. I didn't bring any show and tell. I'm sorry about that. But if you go on our website, quivira.org, you'll see the whole agenda. I didn't even bring a book that I wrote 4 years ago called Revolution on the Range, which is focused on ranching. Dorothy is out of copies, but she said she will take orders if you would like, and we can order some copies later. She's waving her hand back there.
Where's the conference
room? Oh, I'm sorry, gosh. The conference is in the Embassy Suites in Albuquerque, which is right near the Big I Interchange, 14, 15, 16. Folks know Gus Speth. Gus Speth is an environmentalist with Jimmy Carter's administration. He became the dean of the Yale Forestry School, kind of a well-known early climate activist. He's our opening night speaker. He's written a new book called America the Possible. Dorothy, do you have America the Possible here? It's just out.
I don't know where she is.
Gus has got a pretty radical agenda for revitalizing democracy. And here she is. Do you have Gus Speth's new book called America the Possible?
You did have it.
You did have it, okay. So he's our opening night speaker. And Gus is a very thoughtful conservationist who has now sat down and said, look, you know, things just aren't going well in general. We've got to kind of rethink a whole number of things, our politics, our economy, things like that. So he's going to be our opening night speaker, and we're going to have a whole series of folks talk about food and water and soil and seeds, trees. Eat a Tree is one of the talks, you know, whole agroforestry. So there's a whole, I'm here to tell you there's really a lot of good, exciting stuff going on out there. We tend to get a lot of kind of gloom and doom from the news. I think the news, the point of the news these days is to create anxiety in our lives, it seems like. You know? So there's, and underneath all of that, you can find a lot of, if you dig around through the internet, there's actually some pretty cool stuff going on, particularly among the next generation. So Quivira, one of the things that Quivira does is mentor young folks. We put them on ranches, sustainably managed ranches for a year. We have an apprenticeship program we've started. We're going to graduate our eighth apprentice this year, actually. So that's kind of the background to sitting here today. And David, I mean, if you want to hop in with any questions yourself about things, okay. Is that we have this annual conference coming up. I encourage folks to come on down. It's about 500 people. It's also... it's exciting. Folks, you hang out with folks who are trying to solve problems, and it's a very upbeat event. There's Gus Speth's book right there called America the Possible.
Great.
hot off the press, actually. September was a publication date. So Gus has written for Orion magazine. This is actually came out of two long essays he wrote in Orion about kind of, he kind of goes down the list of America at the bottom of all these lists, and then what we can do to try to get back on the top of things. So as a way of a little bit of background about myself, and again, this is a, you know, I don't want to sit here and just talk at you, so if, as I go through this, if you feel like you want to, got a question. So as David mentioned, my background, I came out of the Sierra Club here in Santa Fe. I was an activist. I got kind of fired up in 94 with the Republican Revolution in 94, and got active with the club, and sort of got immersed in conservation issues here in New Mexico. And kind of make a long story short, met a rancher at a Sierra Club meeting who was ranching differently, doing things differently, and we just started talking. This was the mid-90s, kind of in the height of the grazing wars, and Jim Winder was the rancher. He was the only rancher in the state who proclaimed support for the reintroduction of the Mexican wolf, actually. He took a tremendous amount of heat for that. He was ranching differently. He grouped his cows up. He moved them every day, every other day, every two, 3 days, the way that herbivores like to graze in grasslands. Moved them on, didn't overgraze, gave the land lots and lots of rest. Had wildlife, had grass, had water, all the things that I said as a conservationist I wanted. There it was on his ranch. And so I said, whew, we got to talk. So we talked, and we ended up, he and I and another conservationist, Barbara Johnson, also in the Sierra Club, decided to put Quivira together as a nonprofit. 97, just kind of wade right into the grazing wars, try to get at some of these issues about peacemaking and common ground, but built around kind of a new suite of land management tools. At the time, 97, what we talk about today, what he's writing about in his book here, kind of not even on the radar screen. Sustainability? Wasn't a word we used. I mean, it wasn't even on the climate change. I mean, all these kinds of things that we now kind of right at the front of the agenda for all of us. This wasn't what we talked about, though it was what Jim was doing. Okay, so Jim was managing his cattle sustainably. He was growing grass. His methods allowed him to have larger herds. He increased the stocking rate of his animals on his landscape by grouping them together, moving them, growing more grass. Well, he's intensifying food production, right? So he has more cows now coming off his land. We didn't think about it that way. We weren't trying to feed people in 1997. We weren't trying to. We weren't worrying about carbon and carbon sequestration. We weren't thinking about those issues in 1997. I was just trying to find some peace and quiet in the grazing wars. My feeling was that ranchers and environmentalists had more in common than they had in difference. If you started looking at the issues, the subdividers are going to town as ranchers went out of business, right? And laughing all the way to the bank. And so it was really about trying to keep large landscapes intact, trying to get public lands managed better, those kinds of things. And so, and then Quivira, once we sort of waded into that, started working with other ranchers, we did a lot of workshops. The key operative phrase for us is land health, which is a term that Otto Leopold coined way back in the 30s and 40s. You know, land health just means, how is it functioning? What are the functioning parts of the land system? Water, soil, that sort of stuff. Are they functioning properly? When they function properly, grass grows, wildlife eats the grass, cows eat the grass. I mean, it's, it all flows from those basic ecological processes. And so we're trying very hard to get land to be healthy again for whatever purpose you put that land to, right? I mean, if it's a national park, you're not going to graze it, but is it healthy? We're asking those questions. Are wildlife refuges healthy? And then if you went, the scientists are asking the same questions, and all these kind of protocols came out at that time about looking at land health. So then we got involved with creek restoration. We met a man named Bill Zedike. And this is all in the book, Revolution on the Range, which I didn't bring a copy. I'm sorry. We met around 2000, we met a man named Bill Zedike, who was a retired Forest Service biologist who reinvented himself as a riparian restoration specialist. So people know what riparian areas are, which is where the water and streams, that green strip of land meets the brown, you know, land around it. That's a riparian area, dominated by riparian plants, meaning the stuff that grows with its feet in the water. Bill, he had come up with a kind of a low-tech, very simple but very smart way of restoring riparian areas, which are, if I had slides, I'd show you, they're largely degraded. And if you drive around New Mexico, you're going to see a lot of head cuts and big gullies like that. And once you know what you're looking at, it's a lot of places. In fact, this was really driven home to me one day when we were on a ranch in western New Mexico, working with Bill on a creek. And I walked up a side channel that was above my head, a big eroded gully that actually used to be an old road, an old wagon road that caught the creek and down it went with those storms. And I walked up it, and above my head was a fence with fence posts sticking in it. It was a barbed wire fence, and it was the posts were above my head. I asked the rancher what was going on here, and he said that those fence posts sat on the ground in 1935. And that shows you how much erosion has happened in 70 or 80 years. And this is, if you know your Aldo Leopold, everybody know Aldo Leopold, this is what he was writing about in the 20s. He was driving around as the number three guy in the Forest Service headquarters in Albuquerque for the forest. He was chief of the kind of the forest administrative side. And he drove around to all these national forests and wrote reports, and he saw erosion and overgrazing and all these things happening, all these places. He started making connections between the dots. He started writing about erosion. He really was the first person to kind of clearly identify its causes and to raise alarms about it. In fact, he wrote a wonderful piece for Sunset Magazine in 1924 called Pioneers and Gullies. You know, think about that. So he was looking at the same issues that Bill was looking at, the differences that Bill has come up with a methodology for fixing those things. Won't go into all the details. It involves putting structures, rocks and sticks in the right places and creeks, and then you re-meander as storms come. So the point is, for us, we began to extend that idea of land health from ranching, the way the cows moved around the landscape, the herbivores were grazing in that landscape to regenerate the grasses, to the idea of land health and creek systems. How do you restore these systems? How do you restore their function? How do you get that water cycle operating properly, get those grasses to grow again in these degraded systems? Which when I saw that fence across my head, I actually asked, a couple days later, asked a NRCS person. You know, NRCS is the Natural Resources Conservation Service. It's the old soil service for the government. They know everything about soil. It came out of the Dust Bowl years. I asked him, how much the rest of New Mexico it's got these problems. He said most of New Mexico has those problems. And if you really get sort of literate about looking at lands, and we as a culture are illiterate when it comes to land. We don't know, I put myself in that category when I got started, we don't know much about land when we look at it. Aldo Leopold was famous for taking his students in Wisconsin out into a field, farm field, open woodland, whatever, And he'd point at the ground. He'd say, "What's going on here?" He would ask their students to read the landscape, and they would, you know, they'd try and they'd, you know, then you need to know a little bit more about the land use. But he'd talk about erosion, what's causing this erosion, what are the sources. But most of us, even if we consider ourselves conservationists, even ranchers, to be honest with you, are largely land illiterate because we don't know the parts of landscapes. And so we actually, Quivira has done a series of workshops where we just take Bill out and we read the land. We just walk around going, what's going on here?
But isn't that's what the Soil Conservation Service has been doing for a long time. I come from a farming family, and we had the respect for the Soil Conservation Service. And I think somehow... I come from a farming family in Southern California, and we had a great respect for the Soil Conservation Service. And what has happened, and for the government in many ways, and what has happened, I think, since in the 70s, was that there was almost, there's been this cultural shift, and I see it as we're starting to reclaim some of this knowledge that we had, and that we knew, and that... or some of the farming families, and I'm sure, as you're saying, some of the ranching families. I don't know too much about the ranching families, but I think we're gradually reclaiming that, and with trying to, when we lost respect for government somehow with Reagan and all of that, we lost a lot. And when the big, corporations came into agriculture and ranching, I don't know much about ranching. But anyway, so I think we're talking about reclaiming some of this knowledge, too. And I'm glad. And I've seen a lot of New Mexico, and you're absolutely right that it's been terribly overgrazed. But the NRCS, there's a tradition there that we have to recapture too.
We're gonna stop Courtney at about 11:45, and then have about half hour for questions.
Okay, I'm sorry.
Oh no, she was fired up. Right? She wanted to. Yeah. And that's good.
Okay.
Quick comment, and I totally agree with you. And part of it, don't forget, with Reagan and what followed, there were a lot of budget cuts. And so a lot of the quantity of government folks who are just salt of the earth folks. To get some of those soil folks out there, they just really care. And I've met just wonderful, wonderful folks. And you don't go into range work for the government unless you really have a passion for it. I mean, not get paid well and all those kinds of things. You tend to be shot at from all sides. The only thing I would say about that is that part of the issue we've had a little bit with some of the folks in those services is they tend to look at production agriculture. So that how do we produce more cows? How do we produce more food? Not really so much about land health kinds of issues. There's been a shift recently. And so now you're seeing more folks come out of those communities. So in the old days, go back to the 50s and 60s and 70s, it was just really about how to just crank out more cows off these landscapes, how to get more crops off these irrigated grounds, kind of regardless of the consequences for the land function. Okay, so you get through the 70s, you get into the 80s, and you're starting to see kind of a slow but steady shift on a lot of levels. And so you have new ideas in ranch management, you have organic farming coming on, you have permaculture coming in, you're having folks beginning to kind of think about regenerative agriculture as opposed to production agriculture. Does that make sense? Regenerative, how do you use a photosynthesis for your benefit, right? Not just simply create something and rip it out of the land and off to the supermarket. But how do you keep those cycles going, particularly the carbon cycle? So so we sit here kind of at this moment, and behind us is a tremendous amount of work by small-scale organic family farmers kind of working all by themselves here and there. Now it's a movement. You have now a grass-fed beef movement, grass-fed livestock movement. You know, folks know what grass-fed means. It means the animals have eaten grass all their lives, right up to slaughter. If you are a meat eater, that's the way it used to be, right? We go back historically, before World War II, pretty much everything was grass-fed, and then along came production agriculture and the government agencies who said, yes, this is a great thing, get big or get out, you know, right, Earl Butts? So grass-feds come along, organics come along, permaculture has done tremendous things on all kinds of scales. You've got Alan Savory come along, talk about ranching kind of differently. You've now got no-till farming. The folks know about no-till farming kind of coming along. No-till, this has been an education for me in the last couple of years. We didn't work a lot with farmers. But in just the last 3 years, I've really become a big fan of no-till. No-till is exactly what it sounds like, no-tilling. You do not plow. And what we have found through the science of the carbon folks like Christine Jones, there's a universe of life in the soil. I mean, the final frontier for like ecology is protozoas and nematodes. I mean, there's billions of species. They're just figuring this all out. When you plow it, you kill it. This is what we have found. You turn it over, and all that stuff dies. It oxidizes. It doesn't have the water. The air kills it. That kind of stuff. Plowing. How many folks in here have a plowing background? They're just finding out plowing has done more damage over the 5,000 years we've been plowing than almost anything else. It releases all that CO2 back up in the atmosphere, and all those little things die. Up it goes. So no-till is coming along as a way of, and no-till, what no-till means is that they have a no-till driller. It's something they pull behind the tractor, and it just drills the seed straight into the soil. No, it doesn't turn anything over. It just puts the seed in the soil, and a cover crop that protects it. All that stuff grows. So you're seeing a no-till movement. Yes. It, yeah, so how do you deal with weeds? It has herbicides, it has herbicide component to it. Yes, yes. So there's no free lunch, unfortunately. But they've come up with a no-till organic process now, too. Rodale has. It hasn't been widely put to work yet. Yes?
Isn't it true that in Cuba, when they couldn't get their tractors, they found production increased?
Right. So in Cuba, so when the Soviet Union collapsed in the early 90s, Cuba, which was dependent on the Soviet Union for oil, it all got cut off. They got thrown right in the deep end of the pool on their ag, feed themselves or die. And they went right back to the to the oxen and the horse and I don't know about pesticides and herbicides. I think that all went down. They rediscovered organic agriculture, how to farm without fossil fuels. It's changed a little bit now because they're getting oil from Venezuela. Things have kind of shifted back a little bit. But there's a Spanish word for what they did, and the translation is the special occasion or the special moment. It was a special, but they had to figure this out. And they fed themselves. It worked. And they actually, the obesity rates declined. I mean, there are all kinds of benefits that came from eating. My point is that there's all kinds of stuff going on right now. I mean, we've got all these different kind of sustainability movements built around food, around water, about restoration activities that take place in landscapes, bringing in conservation elements, protected spaces, bringing in wildlife, bringing in food production, all kind of managed holistically. It's a pretty exciting time, I think. And you're going to hear a lot about that at the conference. If you come down, you're going to hear about folks. And I'll be honest with you, a fair amount of it is not happening in America. A lot of it's happening in other places around the world. Partly because they have to in some places where they've got some real pressing water issues and land issues, hunger, poverty, things like that. We're a little bit overfed here, I think, as a culture. Australia has been on the front lines for a lot of reasons. I was down in Australia a year ago, just blown away by their innovation. They have a cap and trade system now in place in Australia. You know what cap and trade is? It's they cap CO2 emissions and then they trade those credits, and they're actually going to be paying farmers to sequester carbon in soils. So if you don't know, this is kind of what we've been working on recently. It's all that CO2 in the atmosphere that's causing all these anxiety and trouble. The best way to sequester it and store it is not through carbon capture and storage in underground caves, I think, as somebody is trying to do, but to go through this photosynthesis process and put it into the soil permanently, more or less permanently, through plant roots. Plants will do it for free. You know, that photosynthesis takes CO2 and breaks the C off from the O2, and the O2 goes back out, right? We need that O2. The C eventually, through a long process, becomes, part of it becomes the C in soil. So anybody a gardener, a farmer, you know, organic, you know that the soil organic matter, which is what you look at when you garden, is 58% of that's carbon. So if you build up that dark, rich soil that you get, that's organic matter. That's carbon. And if you can build that up through this process, you're pulling it out of the atmosphere. They've actually done the math. If you could wave a magic wand, and all the grasslands around the world could just double their efficiency, their carbon efficiency, to suck up every bit of excess CO2 in the atmosphere right now. Can we do it? Well, yes, you can do it. We know how to do it. We know how to manage it, the land. We know how to do the animals and the plant things, how to make it work economically, but more importantly, how to make it work politically. I don't know if we want to get into the politics of all of this, which is a bummer right away, you know. But without policy changes at some point, I'll just tell you right now, my personal theory is that if we could pay landowners, just pay them to double the carbon content of soils, we'd make some progress. So that let's say you're a farmer and you went from 2% to 4% organic soil content, and you did it any way you wanted to, you know, organically, with livestock, whatever, but we pay you $100,000 to do that? I don't know. We have money, right? We have money for ethanol. We got money for wars. We got money. So I guarantee you that in the free market, in that sense, would go to town. And the farmers and ranchers would figure out a way to double their organic content. And when you double the organic content of soils, it increases the amount of water that soil will hold. If you know about good organic, dark, rich soil, it holds four times more water, they've done the research, than kind of the industrial industrially degraded, bleached soils that we have around the world. So it's kind of a long journey from 1997, when the three of us were thinking about, God, why are ranchers and farmers killing each other? This is just insane. There are new ideas, new ways of kind of looking at these landscapes. To today, trying to think about, well, we've got 9 billion people. How are we going to feed them? How are we going to do this? We can't say, no, you're not going to have 9 billion people. That's not feasible. Feeding them is going to be tough. It's going to be tough to do it sustainably. It's going to be tough. I don't know if we want to go into some of the policy issues, where the policies right now, especially in America, are geared towards industrial agriculture, right? So Monsanto has permission to do whatever it wants to do, while the rest of us are still kind of out there on the edges trying to figure all of this out. And it's exciting, and I'm particularly excited by what I see taking place in the young people today. And what we call kind of the young agrarian movement. This is kind of a back to an agrarianism that kind of was used to be. Folks don't understand what agrarian, kind of the old, not just farming, it's a way of looking at the land, living on the land, thinking about land, minus some of the nasty stuff that the old agrarianism had, like slavery, for example. The young folks today, it's amazing. We did a conference a year ago. Our conference was on young agrarians, and every speaker except two were under the age of 30. And often you don't give young people a chance to speak. And this was really a good deal. They are obviously technologically totally wired up, but they're business-minded. They get all the sustainable agriculture stuff. They know how to put it to work. And they're extremely well-educated, most of them. And it's interesting. They go into a lot of them. Go into environmental studies, they come out, though, wanting to get into food systems. So you have a lot of farmers and ranchers and folks trying to get into that food system side of things. They're looking at it through this lens of climate change and food, how we're going to feed people. I'm 52. It's interesting to look at, kind of from the outside in on this. It's a strong burgeoning movement. On a lot of levels. There's a National Young Farmers Coalition that's just been put together the last couple of years. A lot of open source, where they're using the internet to talk to each other and trade information back and forth. It's really a key to kind of how they're going about this. They're doing biodiesel, trying to figure out kind of a carbon fossil component. So they're trying to take a lot of which has been kind of pioneered by us, and put it to work in a way that is really cool. And what's holding them down? A couple of things are holding them down. Access to farmland. To get access to a farm or ranch land is too expensive. Where do you get access to it? So there's a lot of effort around that right now. And also the economy. We still have an economy that likes to exploit things, right? Pollute and exploit. And so making money at this. I spoke at a conference a couple of weeks ago in Colorado, mostly to young students at Western Colorado State University. And one young guy raised his hand. He said, that's me. I'm a young agrarian. I'm in food production. I can't make a living at it yet. And he's trying. I'll talk to him a little later. He's trying. He's really hard. They run a garden. He's in farmers markets. He's doing kind of all the right stuff. But he still can't make a living at it. He can't pay health insurance. He can't. There's all these things. And the policies, the federal government policies, are aimed at boosting big ag production, right? So small-scale producers, if you want to, raw milk, if you want to do raw milk, we went to a raw milk dairy in Gunnison, and the only way they can sell raw milk is by shares. Does that make any sense? They actually can't sell it on the market. The government would shut them down. You are not allowed to compete with the dairies. Just not. And so they do it by shares. You buy a share in the cow, and you get raw milk, and they get around it that way. So there are a lot of obstacles to young folks making a living at this, and what's frustrating is that they have the toolbox, and the toolbox has been well developed, and it's really a lot of hard work by a lot of different folks, not just organic and carbon, but also the creeks and the cows and kind of all the different parts, a lot of it which is in these a lot of books that are here. But how do you put it together in a way that is an economy, in a political culture, in a policy culture that is still stuck in the 1960s, I guess, in a lot of ways. It's tough. And it's tough. And part of what we're trying to do at Quivira is keep their spirits up. Keep going, guys. That's why we started an apprenticeship program to put young folks on well-managed ranches so they can get that kind of mentoring that they need and that the older ranchers are really desperate to pass along, because there's a tremendous amount of knowledge kind of at that level that needs to be passed down. And frustrating for us, because when we have one apprenticeship position open, 60 people apply, 60 young people apply, and I can only take one. You know, what do you tell the other 59? You know, good luck. So we're actually trying right now to do that. The conference, we have a social event on the second night that landowners, farmers, and ranchers can come and meet young people. They're all there, and it's kind of a speed dating kind of thing that we do there. It's called weed dating, actually. Weed dating, you heard about weed dating? There's a video. Go type in weed dating into Google and see what you get. You'll get a little video produced by a group called Greenhorns about young people, young farmers trying to meet each other. It's really a cute little video. It's 2.5 minutes long. Weed dating. Well, they're trying to figure this out. They're trying to find each other, trying to support each other. And in a business that's tough. I mean, it's tough, you know, and we're ahead of them in a lot of ways in terms of what we've done, you know, age and money, and they're trying to come behind all of us and figure this stuff out. And Quivira is trying very hard on a lot of levels to give them as much help as we can. He stood up. What does this mean?
Are people wanting to start a back and forth now? Okay.
Let's take questions. I'm good. I'm good.
Good to you.
Back in the back.
What I'll do is pass the mic. Anyone up front first? Or